What are we going to do as a church? Our souls need to wake up. We need to respond to the gospel of Jesus. He said, go into the world.
We don't want to deal with reality, Christian. We don't even want to deal with reality, even though we've been saved from this place.
I'm calling on you today in the name of Jesus to rise up to the call of God. Christ is coming back soon.
If I start telling people about hell, I might just scare them off. Where are you going to scare them off to? Hell number two? People, stop and think about it. If hell really exists, and it does, I didn't say that Jesus did, then don't you think people need to know about it? Can't you at least give them a fighting chance? Or are you just going to sit there and let them burn?
We want to start this show tonight with our feet on the ground. I'm waiting for my brother Rory to call in here. So I just have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just ask you to bless this show tonight and help us to reach people and for their hearts to turn to you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We just ask you for the message to get out as many ways as possible, Lord God, as you desire your will. Let your will be done, Lord God, as we get into this segment of our show. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hello. It's my brother Rory.
Yes, sir. Praise the Lord. How are you?
Yes, I'm fine. Doing great. Happy New Year. And, you know, this year is starting off good. What can I say? Have no complaints. Glad to be out of 2015. But it's for the listeners out there. If you want to reach us, you can find us on don'tletthemburn.com and also on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. We're going to be uploading all our shows to YouTube that we do here on Blog Talk, and we got a couple surprises coming this year. Maybe you'll see our faces for once. We'll see. But, Rory, you have anything to say to the people tonight?
Yes, I do. I just want to say for 2016, it's going to be we're going to go deeper into the Word of God and look and see what's actually going on, what he's actually saying to us through his Word. And all we're here to do is just to share, and not even to try to persuade you to do one thing or the other, but just to give you some options that lay them out before you, and then you can go and do the research yourself, go and look for yourself, and see. And if it lines up with the Word of God, hey, you're going to be benefited. Your life is going to be impacted, and your life is going to be changed for the better. That's what this is all about.
All right. So, hey, how do I sound to you, Rory? Does my mic sound clear? Am I loud?
You're loud, you're clear, but there's some echo there. I hear a little echo.
There's an echo. Okay,
yeah.
Interesting. Wow. Well, I guess we have a little technical difficulty, but let's keep going with the show. So,
yes.
Tonight we are starting with Star Wars, one of the biggest franchise that has ever come out of Hollywood, period. And so tonight we're going to spend a little time on this subject. We're going to talk about the good and we're going to talk about the bad. This is, it's, as the movie says, it's The Force Awakens. And to me, this is a reawakening of this whole franchise, a sort of a reboot within a sequel. But there are many aspects to this film that many moviegoers probably don't know, probably don't care. But as Christians, how do we cope with some of the facts that even the director, the writer of this franchise, as some of the things that he has put in there, how do we cope with that? Oh, How do we tell our kids about what's wrong with the movie, what to kind of like stay away from? And they're big, big portions of this mythology for your young children to stay away from, right?
Well, yes, I think the movie, I also saw the movie. What do I think about the movie, The Force Awakens?
Before you go into the movie, don't go into the movie yet. I got a couple clips. We're going to go back and forth here. So don't go into the movie just yet. Just give me a little thought, like, you know, like a little pre-thought on everything that's going on with the whole
with the franchise. Yes, it was sold to Disney. Disney has taken it over, and I've heard various people talk about it, and also I have spoken about it where for the initiate or for the person that is unawares, they would say, hey, it's a great movie. It shows you, some people say, well, it teaches you about good and evil, but we'll have to talk about all.
We'll get into that.
We're going to touch on that. What else are we going to touch on tonight?
We're going to touch on a couple of video games. We're going to give the people basically sort of the direction we want to go this year. Even though we haven't had full-blown meetings on all of this, but we still have an idea where we want to go this year. And also we're gonna go back to where we left off in our last show, which we're talking about robotics and drones and things of that nature. So that's basically the cusp of the meat of the show right here. So
okay, I'm gonna ask a question before we jump into it. I think before we even get into Star Wars, since we talked about the last show, which is about drones, we can probably do a little recap. I would do a little recap on the drones first. That's number one. We'll do Star Wars, number two, and we'll hit the video games and so on and so forth. There are some other things, too, that we're going to talk about and touch on, too. And I think, like you said, Chris, before, you said that we are going to refocus this year and delve into some of the things that we started out doing in our first show, where we talked about video games. We talked about how it's impacting our children. I think one of the things that we haven't done yet, Chris, and I'm just talking off the top of my head, is we haven't shared with them some of the hidden agendas that are in TV shows. Hidden agendas that are impacting our families, and that's where Chris wants to go back to, is to talk about the shows, the impacts that they're having on families, and how it's changing the family dynamic. It's changing the way a family is supposed to interact. I'll just touch on it a little bit, Chris, and then we move on. Where we should have father, mother, children. Or if you don't have father or mother, there's some that are mothers, some that are playing both roles, father, but there should be a system in place. There should be protocol that is followed in the family structure. And if you want to put that aside, if you look at any business, the business has a hierarchy. So at the top would be the CEO, and below him the CFO, and so on and so forth, and then till you go down to where you have the workers. But there's an accountability, and there's a standard that's in place that people normally adhere to, people normally follow. When these things are eroded, it comes in and it erodes the family structure. It erodes not only the family structure, but consequently, or over time, it erodes society, and society gets eroded. And these are some of the things that we are seeing that's happening, and it's happening now more at an alarming rate than ever before.
Correct.
These are the things that we're going to touch on this year.
Oh, yes. Definitely we're going to get into the family and the culture. We come from the urban black culture, but we have been in many cultures because where we come from, there's Spanish, white, Indian, you name it. We've been in touch with different types of people. And so even though there are different cultures, many of the different cultures have been affected with the music genres and things like that. So we're going to get into those again and cover them on a wider scope, because there needs to be an understanding between the teenagers, young adults, and the parents. If the parents are disconnected from the culture, they won't understand what their kids are going through or what they're being affected with.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So that's just we'll get back on those topics again. So we invited our guest, Pastor Billy Crone, to talk about his documentary, The Attack of the Drones. Skynet is coming, and you can find that at getalifemedia.com. And it's a very good documentary, very well researched. You
very
won't
powerful.
Find another one out there. You won't find another documentary out there that covers the whole aspect of this invasion as much as this DVD. I guarantee you that. So it comes on DVD and on Blu-ray. And even if you want to, it comes out on flash drives. So
yes.
you pick the one you want to get, and it's available. But I encourage you, the listener, to not pass it over. This is it's a little bit ahead of its time. And in fact, every time we talk about something like this, drones or whatever, more news comes out. It's just like
right. We
just talked about it last Sunday, and all of a sudden, like four new articles hit. New things are happening every day on this subject. So again, for the listener, pick up this DVD. It'll be worth every penny. In fact,
Chris,
go ahead. Yeah,
Chris, let me just say, I was, for a person that is always researching and looking into these things, what Pastor Billy Crone did on that drone study was so deep, was so profound, amazing. Skynet is coming. And he started out, and I'll tell you a little bit, folks. He started out talking about Skynet. You know what Skynet is? Skynet is talking about, what's the name of that movie again? Where,
Terminator,
and how the computers took over. And when you see what's actually here, but mainstream media doesn't even comprehend what's going on, you'll be totally flabbergasted when you see what's coming down the pike, number one. Number two, if you don't believe us, the FAA says that all drones need to be, they need to be registered before a certain time. And I'm just telling you, this is how ahead of the curve he was in doing this video. The Lord just led him to do this. And I wouldn't say it's a video. It's not a video. It's a series of videos that once you start, you will not be able to stop. And I, and Chris, you know me. I don't really necessarily talk about this, but I have to talk now, because I think people need to be awakened to see what's coming. And he talked about the drones in that video, Chris. But when I went and I did some side research on the cameras that are available for these drones, oh, my goodness, you'd be amazed. You'd be amazed to see the cameras that you can buy over the counter, the digital cameras, and how they're very small now. Knowledge has increased so much that you can get a camera the size of a keychain that will give you images that are unbelievable. The size of a car alarm, it's a car alarm camera.
Yeah.
You would get some images that are amazing. Okay, and that, folks, that's just to sort of whet your appetite. But there's so much meat to this video that's amazing.
Yeah, so with that, I'll play the audio from the second trailer so we can get into some more discussion.
The primitive forms of artificial intelligence we already had proved very useful. But I think the development of full artificial intelligence could spell the end of the human race.
I believe that humanity is on the cusp of the most important technological, societal revolution that's ever occurred. And that's when we got to the point where the machines that we build outpace us in every respect.
Is AI, artificial intelligence, real? Who's pushing for it? How long have they been working on it? And who's behind it and paying for it?
I don't mean that they're better calculators. I don't mean that they're better at searching. I mean everything. And I think that we're very close.
Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking are among some of the scientists who have signed a letter urging researchers to calm down with artificial intelligence. They argue that artificial intelligence, and specifically autonomous weapons, could lead to the destruction of society as a whole.
Folks, this is the foundation of a Skynet scenario. We are watching it being formed before our very eyes.
The United Nations began an unusual meeting today in Geneva, a discussion about killer robots. And even though they don't exist yet, the technology for lethal autonomous weapon systems are certainly headed in that direction.
And so that's the question. Are we getting close to developing a true artificial intelligence that can actually hijack this new killer global drone technology on the whole planet and create a real life Skynet scenario? Yes.
Once humans develop artificial intelligence, it would take off on its own and redesign itself at an ever-increasing rate.
All right. So, again, Attack of the Drones, Skynet is Coming, by Pastor Billy Crone, GetAlifeMedia.com. So, here you hear them talking about artificial intelligence, and this week, it came out that Japan has basically launched their line of female robots that look human. It's in effect. It's ready to go. So again, more news comes out. So you would think that this is all 20 years from now, 50 years from now, or whatever your imagination can muster. But that's not the case. This is a reality that most people don't even know is coming. So what is your mindset right now as a listener? Do you think this is all make-believe or something that's just being advertised in sci-fi movies? No. The other day, this week, the news came out that they have now a brain-controlled car. Brain-controlled car. And it's been made by some, I think, manufacturers over in Asia. So, first we have the female robots that are ready to go, and now we have brain-control cars. So that tells me that there's a brain interface somewhere. And in fact, in the documentary, there was a brain-control drone. It was on there. It was live video. And you can see the guy being amazed that he can actually control the drone with his brain. So brain interface technology is getting very, it's moving very fast. the increasing rate that this technology is moving, it's just amazing and kind of scary at the same time. But there were pilots back in the 70s or 80s, I think, 70s or 80s, that said that they were controlling already planes with their minds. So this is not a new concept. And, of course, it's not a theory because the news is out. So it's not conspiracy or something crazy like that. Brain interface is real, right?
Yes. They've been looking at this. They've been doing, working very hard at this singularity, where it's the merging of brain, human brain, with computers. And this has been going on for some time, but every so often, or every year or so, knowledge is increasing very rapidly, like it says in the Word of God. In the last days, knowledge has increased, or is increasing, to where it is increasing, not slowly, but it's increasing very rapidly. So it doesn't surprise me where they said, hey, where Japan says, you know, we can make female robots to be almost lifelike. And they have done this. This is not new technology. This is old technology. So this has been ongoing. Not only that, but just like you said, going back to the drones, all these countries are using drones, unmanned aerial vehicles. And it's, folks, when we talk about drones, we're not just talking about something that flies in the air. And I have to say that. We're talking about things that could be as small as an insect or something that walks. I can't remember the name, Chris, but it's able to walk by itself remotely, and things of that nature. So people have to understand that what is coming is every single area of your life, every single area of your life, it can be monitored for the first time. We'll be able to be monitored. Every single transaction, every single hour of every day will be able to be monitored. That's where we're going.
And here it is from the Telegraph in .co in the UK. It says, forget driverless cars. You can soon be driving brain control motors. Chinese engineers from Nankai University in Taijin have developed a system that can read brain signals and control a car accordingly. Currently, the technology can drive a car forward, in reverse, brake, and lock or unlock doors without the need for any physical controls, according to Reuters. Researchers told Reuters they had spent 2 years developing the technology, which consists of a headset with 16 sensors that read EEG signals in the driver's brain and translate them into instructions via software. And there's more, but I'm going to stop right there for a second. So, you know, Google has their little car that they're coming out, the driverless car, you know? And it actually kind of proves to be something dangerous, too, because I remember seeing a demonstration of one of these driverless cars, and it almost ran a guy over. And he definitely wasn't ready for the impact, but it was quite embarrassing. But, you know, he could have been killed, you know? And that's just a tiny incident compared to what can really go on when a virus takes over this computer-controlled automobile or a hijacker or whatever. You know, Tesla is the first company that came out with a fully computerized car. Everything in the car is totally computerized. You could surf the web, do everything that you want from one dashboard. So now they're advancing the technology through Google and through this Nankai company. So basically, as you see, there's a world movement towards technology, which is nothing new, but these technologies were only seen in sci-fi movies. And that's where the awe is inspired in these cases, because, you know, wouldn't it be cool if I could just get in my car and do what I want to do while the car takes me where I want to go or whatever, you know? You ever see the spy movies where the person gets in the back seat, the car locks it, he just can't open it? Just imagine that type of scenario with certain individuals. Imagine cop cars like this. In fact, you know, I don't have the article in front of me right now, but I read something about some type of police force using robots now. Robots.
Yeah.
Robots. And not the aerial drones. Robotic police force
to get the human out of it, to be able to do other things, or to go in and take care of an area. And Chris, what comes to mind when I see all of this is that these images are first cast. They cast the images in the movie. These images are cast in the movie. You see things like Captain America, where the DNA of the man is altered. One, you see Iron Man, where he sends out these robots to quell the crowd. Hey, take it easy. And we look at these things, and these images are put forth in man's mind, in men's mind, the mind of men. And these are the things that men go after. They deny the very God that created them. How bad is that? That's horrible.
The interesting thing, though, is that a lot of these movies are basing a lot of their stories from comic books. So these ideas were already instituted in comic books many, many years ago. I remember reading strange stories like this back in the 80s when I used to read comic book 80s, early 90s. And all of these ideas were there. Driverless cars, drones, blah, blah, blah. You name it, they're all there already. It's just that in certain parts outside of the military industrial complex, these ideas were unknown. The brain interface and the RFID and all these other things, you know? But now we see it come in the past where you can't call it science fiction anymore. You can't call it a comic book anymore. And of course, and I'm not even saying that what you're saying, I'm not even, you know, casting some shadow over that. It's true. Hollywood is pushing a large agenda, whether it be from the director or the writers or the studio, whatever. Wherever it's coming from, the agenda's there, because they have to still do research to see what kind of technologies coming up in the industries, like from DARPA or wherever else. So, and we heard that from the guy that did the Terminator, that wrote the Terminator movies, Terminator 3 and 4. And he said he went there and he told them that they were making some interesting ideas for the movie, and the doctor said we're already working on stuff like that. So they're way ahead of us on all of this stuff. The movies make it seem like it's fantasy. You know, Rory?
Yes, I'm right here, my brother.
All right.
They look at, yes, like you said, they look at these things and they start drawing from these things, but it goes to the only thing that I could say, Chris, is that what comes to mind is that you go back on the plain of Shinar, we go back in the book of Genesis, where God says, you know, I'm going to have to go down and confound these men because they're on one accord. And their men were so warped at the time. They were so off target. They didn't want to do what God had told them to do. Be fruitful and multiply. Go and repopulate the earth. They said, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to stay right here, and we're going to build a tower go up to heaven. And today we are seeing that men are trying to do the same thing through technology, through technology merging with machinery, to gain a deeper worldly insight and not a godly insight into what he would have us to do.
No, exactly. And I have this clip here that's is telling you the truth about the robots and how they're going to be integrated. And this is all about Japan right here. So I'm going to play this clip so that you can understand that this is already here, people.
So you work to
Sophie,
get...
thank you for inviting me.
Yeah. So
oh, I'm sorry. That is just the wrong clip. I'm sorry about that. Where did it go? Go ahead, Rory, while I look for this.
Okay. Well, what I wanted to do was I wanted to go over some scriptures about what's going on in our world today. And I just wanted to let
here
people know that the Word of God spoke about all these prophecies a long time ago. Extreme materialism, for the first time, extreme materialism is going on. 2 Timothy 3, verses 1 and 2. Increase in speed and knowledge. Daniel 12:4. Go and look those scriptures up and see. Daniel had a vision of what was coming in the future. And today, we are living in a world where technology is taking off. You know, before you go into it, Chris, before you play that clip, one of the things that is fascinating to me, I remember when phones first came out, cell phones.
Mm-hmm.
Cell phones came out, they were as big as your head almost. Right?
Yeah.
As big as, right? Remember they had one called the brick. It was so big.
Yeah. Yeah.
And at that particular point in time, when you had that phone, you were really the king, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
But today, and it's been, what, 10, 15 years, maybe, at the most?
More
today,
than
that same, right, that same phone that was the brick, that was as big as your head, today you have a phone the size of a watch that can do more than that cell phone 20 years did, the size of a watch that you put on your hand. I think we need to stop for a minute and look and see what's going on. Look, and when I say look, ask the Lord to open your eyes or open the eyes of your heart to see what's going on and how things have propelled or moved so fast, so far in advance that men are just have lost themselves, are losing themselves in technology.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want you to look at that. Go ahead, Chris.
All right, here we go.
At this care home outside Tokyo, it's time for morning exercise. But today, it's being led by a robot. Palro is just 40 centimeters tall. He can walk, talk, dance and sing, and even tell you tomorrow's weather forecast. The old people here seem to love him. I feel very happy when I talk to him, says this man. I feel a little embarrassed to say it, but he behaves a little like a human. Getting robots to be more like humans is the holy grail for developers. And right now, Erica is the state of the art. She's currently telling me the plot of her favorite film.
The thing that's really different about Erica is not that she can just respond to a much larger number of topics. It's the way that she moves. She moves towards you when you speak. She blinks her eyes. She moves her cheeks and her mouth. It is really quite uncanny how human she looks.
Erica's inventor is Professor Hiroshi Ishiguro. Sitting next to his own robot clone, He says his ultimate goal is to blur the line between robot and human.
And the human has the two ways for the evolutions. One is a gene, of course. The other is the technologies. By using a technology, we can extend our abilities. Technology is changing the human definition itself. The technology is a way of evolution. Do we need a robot? Yes, of course. And especially in Japan, you know, Japanese population is going down. But still, you know, we expect to have a same quality of life. And in such case, I think we definitely need to use a robot technologies.
How about a robot that becomes part of you? At Cyberdyne Systems near Tokyo, they've already taken the first step, a strap-on exoskeleton.
Okay, so this is an example of how not to pick a heavy object up. But with this, it does all the work for you.
The effect of the full exoskeleton is even more dramatic. This man has suffered spinal injuries and is learning to walk again.
If these patients can start to use these devices, the total physical function also improves.
Using the robotic legs, the patient is soon walking again. These robotic legs have been shown to work with polio victims and even amputees. The bionic man is no longer science fiction.
Sometimes I dream of living forever, to never die, not unless I wanted to. Actually, I dream I could just know everything, to have super intelligence, super strength for that matter, and super speed.
All my life, I want to know my family.
We haven't seen each other for 70 years. I didn't know I had a twin brother.
All the years was lost. And I kind of give up hope.
In my heart, I always had a feeling that I did have a twin brother.
And for 70 years, I live with the unknown things.
All right. You see how desperately wicked the mind, the heart of man is. Desperately wicked. You see these people getting so caught up in this fake reality, these humanoid robots that accompany them, teach them. They want to go inside the robots with their souls or their minds or whatever you want to call it. It's just incredible how these things were once sci-fi. And now they've become a complete reality, and it's going to get worse. Were you there? All right, guess not. So, people.
I'm here, my brother. Sorry about that.
All right. You know, they are inventors of evil things, just like Romans 1:30 describes, you know, it describes backbiters, haters of God. They're violent, they're proud, they're boasters. They're disobedient to parents, and on it goes. But inventors of evil things, things. Now, we're created in the image of God, but now we want to be God and create things in our own image. And that's how deep it's getting, people. And again, I know we've been promising to do a total whole show on transhumanism, but trust me, the research is deep, and it goes far back. And all of this robotic agenda goes towards this whole transhumanism movement too. But at the same time,
and like you said, Chris, people need to know these things are not just happenstance. They didn't just come about yesterday. These things started from the 50s. Mm-hmm. These things started from the 50s. Funding was given to all the colleges in the United States, and that's how these things came about. So, yes, they're God haters. They're men that plan and plot evil things. So much so now that we heard in the clip earlier that Stephen Hawking, a man who doesn't even believe in God, says, listen, I think we are about to jump off the precipice. where we are going to go into something that we will not be able to come back from. And that's where we're past that. I think we're already past that. When you actually take a look and see what's coming, you know, you would want to go back and look and read the Word of God and see what it says. Read it for yourself. Read it for yourself. Don't listen to what other people say about the Bible. Go and ask the Lord to open your heart and go in and read. The book of John is a great book to read. Read the book of John. Find out for yourself. Don't take anybody else's, don't even take my word for it. Don't take Chris's word for it. Go and seek for yourself. Don't listen to anyone else. Just take the Bible and see. And when he reveals himself to you, then you can say, you can come back and you can come back and talk to us. I'm open.
You know, I want.
And when you see what the Word of God says, you'll see. Go ahead, sir.
I want to add to what you said. Go read the Bible. Seek God with a pure heart. Because if you're just getting in there to disprove God or say it's full of this and full of that, it's the wrong heart. It's just an unbelieving heart. Approach God with a believing heart. He will reveal himself to you. And for those of you that are saved, get into the Bible deeper. You know, we talk about all of these robotic things and the occult and all these. All of this is in the Word of God already. It might not be called robot, but it's already in there. The whole future of mankind has already been prophesied. We're just seeing it unfold in front of us day by day by day. We have a caller, so let's take this caller. Hello, caller.
Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Hello.
Good night. Hello, good night.
Yeah, I've been listening to your show. It's so educating and informational.
Thank you.
A few weeks ago, you brought a pastor, Pastor Billy?
Yes, Pastor Billy Crone.
And he was talking about the drones. There was so much to absorb. And I just want to say you guys are doing a great job.
Thank you very much.
But you know what? As I'm listening to you more, I understand this, what's going on in the world better when it comes to technology being used to get ready for the chaos to come.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm wondering how's it gonna look like? I would like to listen to your own perspective. It seems the machines are taking over so many things today.
Yes.
Is there any Bible perspective to this? What should we do? Because if we think about it naturally, why don't we become anxious?
Yes.
When you wake up every day and you hear a new thing that the machine is taking over, is this the way it's going to continue? I want to hear from you. I'll be listening.
All right. Thank you so much. It's going to keep going in this way because these humanists out there, we're not even talking about the transhumanists yet, just the humanists. They, of course, want to get rid of God out of everything. And so, in turn, they want to become God. And so, they invent these things to eventually see, on one end, they want to do good for mankind. You will hear that all the time. But on another end, you'll hear about a control mechanism. There are many people out there that are talking about privacy and all these other things because it's a real threat. And that's why Stephen Hawking is warning, and he's an atheist, so he's not even coming from a biblical aspect. And there are other computer business tycoons that are warning on the same level, the artificial intelligence, the robot wars, the drones, because here's the main premise of this whole thing. Eventually, it can all be taken over by one person. Whether we call them the Antichrist or the world leader or whatever, they have an infrastructure building right now that is able to take over the networks, your phones, whatever. And I know it sounds even strange, but I just watched the James Bond movie the other day, Spectre. And Spectre is this organization that's basically running everything around the planet, but nobody knows who they are. And the last thing they were trying to do was build this database that could control and watch everyone from anywhere. And isn't that the same thing getting built right now, Rory?
Yes, they're doing all of those things. But what I'm going to do, Chris,
mm-hmm.
although men are doing all of those things, I would go back to mm-hmm. to the word just to answer the question that our dear brother asked.
Mm-hmm.
What should we do? Yes, there are advances in technology,
mm-hmm.
but. And I'm going to go back to, and I told you earlier, I spoke about Daniel 12, verse 4. And Daniel had this vision. And he saw all of these things that were coming to a head. And Daniel, they said the book of Daniel is the skeleton of prophecy. It gives you the entire thing. Daniel was able to, he was so in tune with God that God showed him everything that was going to come on. And in 12:4, it said, "But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase." Okay? And it goes on. But this is the time we were talking about, you know, where it says, look, Daniel was concerned about all of these things taking place. But our focus needs to be on Jesus Christ. Our focus needs to be honed into the Word of God. You know, not turning to the right or to the left, but looking to the author and finisher of our faith, looking to Jesus Christ. Because here it is. He is the one that told us all these things that were coming to pass. And if we look in the Word of God, in the Bible, and turn on the TV, read the newspaper, read any magazine, it would be evident. It would be very evident that you would see that, hey, things are coming to a head. Everything is coming together. You are hearing of wars, rumors of wars. Wars today are not fought the same way. There's a war against drugs. There's a war against terrorism. There's a war against this. There's a war against that. There's people are plotting to do various events, and the police goes in and they take them out. So there are wars going on a daily basis. And the war is the war for your soul. That's what it is. It's a war for your soul. And what's happening is if you turn on the TV, there's a war going on. There's an image that's being blasted to you. And they're telling you, hey, listen, there are things that are going to make your life better. This is there for you, that's there for you. We talk about a little bit about robotics. We talk about drones, like Pastor said. There are a lot of different things that are going on. But you know what? If we go back, and what they used to do in the old days, you'd go and buy flour. I'm just going to give you an analogy. You'd buy the flour. And the only way for you to get the lumps of the flour out was you have to use what's known as a sieve. And even today when you're baking a cake or whatever it is, you have to sift the flour to make sure all the impurities are out. The same way, we'd have to use the Word of God as a sift, and we'd sift through all the things that are coming because the Word of God is going to stand. He says, heaven and earth will pass away before anything falls out of His Word. So everything that's tangible, everything that we know as real and see, will pass away before anything falls short in His Word. That's how mm-hmm. powerful His Word is. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're saying. We need to, yes, these things are there, and we're showing you these things. But most importantly is the Word of the living God. You know, Chris, mm-hmm. one of the things I normally say to people is, what did Jesus ever do? Did He carry a gun? Did he shoot anyone? Did he hurt anyone? He didn't do any of those things.
He came and he helped the poor. He helped the needy. Wherever there was someone hurting that came to him, he would try to help them. There was no, he never fought anyone, yet he was killed. He came into the church. He went into the political arena because he saw, he was concerned about the heart of men. The heart. That's the whole entire thing. The heart. Where is your heart? And that's what this is all about. It's about the heart of men. And we're showing you tonight, we're showing you how men's hearts have gone off course. It's veered off course. And they're going after things that are totally dark, destructive, and you can actually say, yes, demonic. But the word of God is there. It's evident. Mm-hmm. It's real. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's light. It's a light that shines. When God came, he said, the word became flesh and dwelt among men, and men could not understand it. He came in and he blew away. He blew out tradition. He came into the church itself, the synagogues at the time, the seat of learning, the seat of these men who studied all these different things. And he blew them away. Blew them away in the sense that he was the very word of God. He was the Son of God, God with us, Emmanuel. And he came and he shared with them. He opened his heart. And men could not deal with that. Some fought. Some got saved, of course. This is what we're dealing with today. And if we were to go into any school of higher learning, some schools, the schools that started out as Christian institutions today, they would look at us and laugh us to scorn because we're not going after the things that are that are popular today. We are looking at the word of God, and it stands. It will stand when we are fought, when we're gone. These are, Chris, I know I'm talking a lot, but today one of the things that Pastor said was he was talking about the law of gravity, just to give you an analogy of the word of God. These are some laws that are put in place that no human being can say they weren't put in place by someone. If you jump off a building, you're going to fall. You're not going to fly. You're going to fall. That's right. The law of gravity. You're going to fall. If it's a one story, you'll fall to the ground. If it's a 10, you're going to fall off. So if someone else comes, and he could be the king of Egypt, or he could be the king of the world, if some people want to say, or the most powerful man in the world, if Donald Trump came by, or whosoever is running, and they said, well, listen, we're going to throw you off the building, but you're not going to fall. Mm-hmm. There are laws that God has put in place. And those are physical laws. And there are some spiritual laws that we have to adhere to. And one of the spiritual laws that he put in place, he says, as long as the earth remains, it's spiritual and both physical, there'll be seed time and harvest. There'll be a time to sow and a time to reap. So, you know, what time to sow? Are you talking about farming? Well, yes, there's a time to sow and a time to reap. Well, if you're a young man, there's a time to sow. You go to college, you grow, you learn, you acquire knowledge, you get a job, you work, and later on you start reaping those benefits. Oh, okay. What about the word of God, though? There's a time to sow. A time to sow where you live your life and you're sowing. And there's a time in the afterlife, where a time when you pass on into the next life, there's a time to reap. It's appointed for a man to live once, and then after that they die, and there's a judgment. There's a judgment, and that's one of the hardest things that people have to deal with today. There's a time coming. There's a judgment. We are appointed only one time to live. We can't we can't do like, remember when we were little kids, Chris, and we were playing a game or something like that, and they say, okay, we messed up. Let's do it over. Let's have a do-over. There's no do-overs. You can't do it over.
I guess who's trying to say, so guess who's trying to say that you could do it over, though? The wicked heart of man, the transhumanists. Exactly. They want to play life like a video game. You die, you come back in a robot body. You die, you come back in an avatar body. You die, or you come back in whatever, a hologram,
They think they've figured it all out. Okay.
But not only that, they're also showing you, they're trying to show you or to teach us that life is meaningless.
Mm-hmm.
They're diminishing the meaning of life. And God says, listen, it's appointed for man to live once. And after that, there's a judgment that comes. What are you doing today that is different from we just started a new year than last year? What are we going to do different? What are some of the things that we're going to change? What are some of the things that we're going to say, you know what? Last year I wasted my time. This year I'm going to really see if I can dig into the Word of God, see if He's really real, like these two guys are saying, and find Him for myself. And if He's real, I'm going to need to do, you know, these guys are saying that He's real. I need to do something totally different than what I have done before. I've always listened to other people's opinions. Let me see what it says for myself. And these are some of the things that we can do. Go ahead, my brother.
Yeah, totally agree with everything you're saying. And so just to, like, try to finish off the segment of the program and still try to answer what the question was along with what you're saying and what I said before, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Luke 21:26. Just imagine, we've seen many things on this planet already that would cause, you know, cause you to fear, cause you to faint, cause you to run to the hills, whatever. But what could it be that's going to cause men's heart to fail them? Just have a heart attack as soon as you see it. It's that scary. Could be, we don't know exactly what that answer is. But just imagine the takeover of drone robotics, mechs, and all these other gigantic things that they're building. And here goes in this article, just to go back on the RoboCop aspect, this Nightscopes, that's the company that's making it, Nightscopes K5. K5 is the name of the robot. The security robots, they say it resembles a mix between R2-D2 and a Dalek from Doctor Who. If you've ever seen Doctor Who, you know those black menacing robots with the gadgets on them and the lasers. It looks sort of like that, but white. And it says the system behind these bots is a bit Orwellian. The K5s have broadcasted and sophisticated monitoring capabilities to keep public space in check as they rove through open areas, halls, and corridors for suspicious activities. And this is from Drudge Report. But I'm not going to go further into it, but these are the things that are being built right now, being used right now. In fact, in Russia, already put automated robots with artificial intelligence inside them. Now, we don't know how sophisticated this artificial intelligence is, but the point is that they're doing it. And now you mix that with what Google and Facebook are doing. They're feeding their AI with the information through the servers, the search engines. So whatever you put in, or the scanning of the books that they're doing, all of the books, remember, they're scanning the whole world's books, all they're just going places, paying big millions of dollars to scan every book ever written, and they're feeding it to this AI. So you think about that, and you gotta wonder where all of this is all going and what the world is going to be like in, let's just say, 20 years. Just to say that. I'm not even going to put a big number on it.
We don't have to go that far. We can actually say 10 years. We can actually say 10 years, my brother. We can actually say 10, or even. But look, Chris, we don't even have to go so far. One of the things that Pastor was talking about, or you were talking about, was how children are disobedient to parents, how some of these things are going on. And what I would say is that, you know, we can readily point to the sources. Oh, it's TV. Oh, it's the computer. Oh, it's this. These are the different influences. But it's the core of that, or the main ingredient that's missing is the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and that's what's going on. And before we go, I want to read one more thing. It's Luke 17, verse 26, and a couple other verses after. And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat. They drank. They got married. They had wives. They were given in marriage unto the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed all of them, or them all. Likewise, as it was in the days of Lot. In the days of Lot. They did eat and they drank, and they bought and they sold, and they planted and they built. But the same day Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Why am I reading that? Because you know what? God is sitting back, and there's going to be a day of judgment that we are all going to have to look and deal with.
Amen.
Go ahead, Chris.
So, moving on, we're going to try to get through the rest of this in 57 minutes. So, we're going to go to video games really quick, and we're not going to spend too much time on that because we must cover the aspects of Star Wars. So, the first game we're going to talk about is Call of Duty Black Ops 3. We talked about it before, but I still haven't even got into the single player to see what it's all about and everything. But I've researched on the zombie mode. And, of course, we did our whole show on zombies and what they mean and all these other things and the spiritual aspect. Now, in Call of Duty Black Ops 3, the new zombie mode, you have to – it sort of mimics one of the first zombie modes. Let me explain for a minute. It's where you the hordes of zombies are coming at you. You pass different levels, but by a certain time, you can acquire powered-up weapons by getting this machine called a pack-a-punch. And the pack-a-punch means the gun is more powerful, so the hordes of zombies can be repelled quicker. Okay, got it? So now I'll play a clip from the new zombie mode. Somebody's explaining what you do to get the pack-a-punch and what you have to do to initialize this whole sequence. So here we go.
What's up, guys? I'm Alfredo, and this is how you unlock the pack-a-punch Easter egg in Black Ops 3 Zombies. The zombies map we're focusing on today is called Shadows of Evil. The Easter egg Pack-a-Punch allows you to upgrade your weapons at a cost and can be the difference between success and failure in zombies. There are four collectibles scattered across the map, each tied to a specific ritual site. On today's episode, we'll go over the location of each collectible, their ritual site, and how to build Pack-a-Punch. Note, although the collectibles are tied to specific ritual sites, you can gather the pieces and start the rituals in any order. First up, the summoning key. In the starting area, use the purple fountain to turn into the beast. Then destroy the wooden crate sitting on the truck nearby. Now that you have the summoning key, you can start gathering the artifacts needed to complete the rituals. First collectible, Lawyer's Pen. The pen is located just past the first gate. Turn into the beast and activate the power switch for the crane. The crane will start to move and drop the pen. First ritual. Once you have the Lawyer's Pen, turn into the beast and unlock the ritual site. Simply place both the summoning key and the pen onto the ritual table, fight off a horde of undead, and gather the gate worm. Second collectible, the detective badge. Run over to the canal district. Once there, turn into the beast, break the crate, break down the rift door, we'll use that for later, and activate the power. Once you're in human form again, make sure to collect the detective's badge. Second ritual. This is performed in the nightclub at the canal district. Just like before, again, turn into the beast and activate the power for the staircase. Once inside, place the summoning key and the badge onto the table. Fight off another horde and collect your second gate worm.
All right. Bro, are you there? Boom.
Yes, I'm here.
All right. So,
I'm here.
We got a game that comes with many things to do. And this zombie mode is very, very, very popular. In fact, I used to play it in the other games. But it's very popular. And now let me say one thing. The aspect of witchcraft was already in it. The player, in the beginning, didn't use that aspect. It was being controlled by the evil
girl that died by some experiment. Now you get to do rituals as the player. And this happened in one of the other games, too. You had to do some other stuff, but that's not relevant anymore. This right here is more relevant because this game just came out in November, and now kids are going to be able to do witchcraft rituals. If you're listening carefully, they have to pick certain items up to do this ritual, and that's how rituals is done. You know, you got the lawyer's pen, you got this and that, and you do your spell. And if you actually see the game, there are other demonic elements in it too, as far as in this zombie portion. And then you have where you turn into a beast. So he says the beast, you know. I'm not going to make too much out of that, but the aspect of turning from human form to animal form comes straight out of witchcraft. When you hear of werewolves and witches that turn people into animals and shape-shifting, straight out of witchcraft. So, Rory, you have anything to say about that before we go on to the next piece here?
Well, what I would just say is, first of all, you wouldn't have to go that far into the game. I don't even have to go there. What I would go is, why would you allow your child or purchase this game for your child where the mind is being conditioned? The mind is being conditioned to shoot, to kill. They're seeing all sorts of these evil things, even before you go to, like the guy was saying, a ritual. And this clip is just horrible. It's a horrible thing. But what it's actually doing, it's conditioning the mind. You see? It's conditioning the mind because no matter what you have to do, it's telling the person, you want to get to the next level, this is what you have to do. And basically, they're just lost. If you condition a person's mind to do those, play those games, it's not just a game. Those games teach you the different weapons. Am I correct, Chris?
Oh, yeah.
It definitely teaches you different weapons that are used, the different weapon systems. And I'm not talking about something that's fake. I'm talking about real weapon systems. It teaches you how much ammunition it has, this, that. It goes on the whole entire gamut. So you're able to learn a lot more. And it also conditions the heart and it conditions the mind. Why am I telling you? You think this is crazy? These are what are used by police force, military, to train soldiers to kill. And those and what they do is, when they're making these video games, they hire ex-soldier, ex-Green Beret, these men who have been in combat, who have killed. And this is this, to put it lightly, and it's not lightly, this is the spirit that you're allowing to come into your home in the form of a game. That's all I got to say, though.
So it's a pretty compelling thing that, you know, parents are buying this for their 6-8-year-olds and these little guys. And, you know, as you grow up, you have your own responsibility to buy whatever games you're going to get. But, you know, when parents are bringing this into their home and they don't even know what it consists of, it's a dangerous thing. It's just like how when Harry Potter came out, the witch covens grew because of it. And even there's a soldier in the military, the U.S. military, that said, because they have covens in the military now, he said that it was because of Harry Potter why he was interested in witchcraft. So as we go on to the next game, I just want to play the opening trailer for this. It's a short trailer for this game called God Us. God Us. And it's basically, you know what, let me just play it and you'll hear it for yourself. Here we go.
I've learned that anyone can be a god, so long as someone believes in them. My journey started with these two devoted followers. They looked up to me for nurture and inspiration as they developed their lives. I could sculpt and mould every inch of this beautiful landscape using only my touch. As I've grown in power, so has their civilization thrived. I've watched my adoring followers as they've lived and learned and loved and enriched their lives as they progressed through the ages of humanity. However, the path has not been without difficulties. At times it has been challenging, but I've had the power to prevail.
So there you have it. The game is called God Us. What he's describing there is a game where you get to... did you hear what I said before? All right, here we go. This game is all about being on a... you're making a planet, and you start off with two people, a man and a woman, and you nurture them, they believe in you, and they start to build a civilization, and people choose to worship you or cause chaos. Basically, this game is promoting you becoming a god. You heard when he started out, he said anyone could be a god in this game. So one is promoting self-worship. It's promoting you becoming a god, which is a new age lie. Not just new age, it's in other religions too. The lie from Satan, when he told Adam and Eve that they'll be like gods. Same lie. And here it's packed in a video game marketed to kids. So this New Age or Luciferian doctrine, it's, you know, again, be careful what you're bringing into your house if you don't understand it. Be careful, especially as Christians, the spirit behind some of these games, desperately wicked, and it always goes back to getting the children. You see, most of the adult minds are already brainwashed to go that way, or they're already in sin, so you know they're gonna do what they want to do. You know, first law of Satanism, whatever. But the kids, even though they're born in sin, they can be trained to go that way very easily. So, Rory.
Yes, my brother. I would just say the same about the last one, the same thing I said. It's just that, and I would have to go and say, parents, we have to be so vigilant today more than ever. Vigilant to see what our children, what we're purchasing for our children, what our children are into. Because it's not just a video game, but knowledge has increased so much that the cell phones that we are using today, they can probably store 1,000 or more, sorry, not just 1,000, thousands of people's name, address, phone number, pretty much all the credit card numbers that they have, and much more information on their cell phone. On the cell phone. So what I'm trying to show you by showing you the mass amount of data that can be stored in a cell phone is that it opens to the child a world that you're not even exposed to. And that's what happens today. And furthermore, when you give a child a video game like that, before you know it, there are things that the child is being taught that you will not even see manifest until years later. This is what most people are not even looking into. Most of the mass shootings that happen in this country, children are taught how to shoot and use a gun by first playing video games. Nobody talks about that. Nobody wants to say that. So for me, and I, you know, based off what the Holy Spirit has shown, I would never get a shooting game for my kids. I try not to get into those. They've asked, they've said, and we don't do shooting games. I don't. because now you could play a game for a week or 2 weeks and not finish the game. You're in your own world. You're in a world where other people are playing, where they form teams. Like you said, you start off as one, and before you know it, you have a team. And in this game, I don't know the game, but people, now they're looking into being worshipped. Who is that? Who said that? The devil himself.
Yes, he did.
And these are the things that we got to get out of the homes in the name of the Lord.
Yeah. It's dangerous, dangerous material here. And I know, you know, some people are going to scoff at it and say, you guys are just talking, it's just a game, blah, 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 you know. But we know there's a spirit out there that wants your children, that wants you, that wants you. So don't be fooled by your own thoughts. Be careful of what you're bringing into your home. And so from there, we're going to go on into the next subject, which we started on, is Star Wars. And we mentioned earlier that Harry Potter increased the amount of people going to the covens, the witchcraft worship places. Can't even call it a church. But here in this Drudge Report, it says in Berlin, a church in Germany capital invited Star Wars fans to attend a special service Sunday themed on the sci-fi blockbuster in attempts to attract more young people in the pews. About 500 people heeded the call and attended the service, some carrying lightsabers, props, or wearing Darth Vader masks. It was more than twice as many as usual come to Zion Church on a Sunday. This is a quote. It says, "We were very happy to see many people in the church today," said Protestant Pastor Lucas Ludwig. He said, after the service, it's great that there are subjects that people are interested in. They trust us to make them part of the church service without making it too Christian or too Star Wars, but to find a good compromise. That word compromise shouldn't even be there. But there it is, right? And there's a report that said that the actual people that started the religion of Star Wars, which is also based off of witchcraft, their numbers are growing because of this new resurgence of the mythology or the franchise of Star Wars. But before I say more...
Well, Chris, they actually started a church in the UK. They started a church.
Yes, it's everywhere now,
In the UK, where people are actually going and starting that religion. So...
Mm-hmm. Or continuing it.
So now people are looking for a force. There's a force that they're looking for to worship. I can't even remember what it's called. But I saw that article too, where people are going to do that. And this is how far off we have become. You know how far off people have gone. That things are now becoming a religion for them from a movie.
Yeah, and the thing is, Star Wars has been a religion for a while now. I think since the 70s when it first came out, people were taking it way too serious. Just like when Avatar came out, people were willing to commit suicide because they couldn't be in that 3D world. So they're unhappy with God, with what God has provided them, and they want something else, something that man can make. I guess man is supposed to be better than God. But whatever. You know, here it is. We're in an age where a lot of these things are coming about. So to stick with Star Wars here, we're going to play a few clips, and we're going to talk in between the clips because we want you to get a full understanding that this is not an attack on the movie. This is just a warning about some of the things inside of this mythology, and we're going to even hear from George Lucas himself some of the things that were put in there. But in the meantime, we're going to hear from somebody from the 70s that talked about this. Here we go.
What do I think is wrong with Star Wars? About everything. One is that everybody that signs a contract on Star Wars is an initiated witch and had to prove what brotherhood they belong to before they could star.
Everybody goes, really?
Yes. Now, this is fact from talking with the people who produced the show. Second, the guy who played Luke Skywalker on the show, some of you from having the television bug, may realize that he starred in the premiere of Eight Is Enough. They had him to a contract, and he wanted out of it because he didn't, because it became a series. And he said, I want out of it. And they said, no. And they said, well, we're going to do a follow-up of Star Wars called Star Trails, which is so. And I want out of it, and you better let me out of it if you know what's good for you. And they said, no. And they said, well, I'll just finish your show. I'll cast a spell and kill one of the leading stars, which he did. They let him out of the contract because he turned to the producer and says, you're next. The real reason for Star Wars is that five of the major doctrines of witchcraft are taught all the way through the movie, and that the statistics coming in now are over 1 million people have joined witchcraft because of the movie since it's now. Now, I talked with the man who handled all the publicity for the movie. He verified everything I'm saying. He also said that, I said, well, I guess about 75%, and I still believe that, 75% of the movie was witchcraft. He said, no, only about 45. I said, well, what about Star Trek? He said, oh, that's 95%. I said, well, what about making everybody in witchcraft in it? He said, oh, they are. Everybody in it has to be. I said, well, who's going to be the new star? And he said, oh, the guy, and you probably won't know his name, so I'll tell you who he played, all you women that like soap operas. He played Snapper on Young and Restless. Now, that's not unusual, since the three major soap operas, you must be a witch before you star in them. Young and Restless was the last to go. That's why there was a big changeover in Young and Restless staff recently. The other two are All My Children and Secret Storm. So if you parents think that your kids are the ones that get it all because of the rock music. What can I tell you? I met a PR man recently who told me he is the public relations man for the new Star Wars sequel. He's a homosexual. He told me there's not one star that's a major star in the new movie that has not gone to bed with homosexuals in order to get the part. He also said the majority of them are being picked from the top occult soap opera in the country. Does anybody have an idea of what that soap opera is? Young and Restless. Reason? Brad, for those that watch it, is a Christian who counsels through astrology. And one of the new stars is Snapper, the doctor on the show that will be in Star Wars. And the guy told me that instead of 45% of the Star Wars thing being on the Force, 99% will be about the Force. And for the guys who like country western music and think they're safe because it's not rock, Tom T. Hall has just brought out the best-selling song in a long time. It's called The Force, about good witchcraft battling bad witchcraft.
I have personally talked with Johnny Todd on the basis of Jack Chick's recommendation. Having known Johnny Todd now for more than 4 years, and my having known him for some 6 months, I believe that Johnny Todd is a genuinely converted man, saved by the grace of God out of the depths of Satanism.
Yeah. So, you know, I was going to say most of those things from my own thoughts about the movie and some of the things I've researched before. So, I played that clip because that band is, even though he's not around anymore, was well respected for the information that he let out about a lot of things back then in the 70s when he disappeared or whatever. But I just wanted to start off that way to
and he disappeared.
Get you. Yeah, he disappeared.
And he disappeared. Yeah. And he disappeared. They don't know where he is. He was the one who blew the lid off of the record industry at the time.
Mm-hmm.
He was the one who. So this person that he has been in it and around it for a long time.
Yeah. So now nobody knows where he is.
And nobody knows where he is. He just vanished, and you know. But
all right,
we're going to talk about the clip that we just played, or you want to move on to the next clip?
Yeah, go ahead. I got a couple more, but we got time.
Well, it's not surprising to me at all because of, number one, because of Hollywood. Number two, because they don't promote Jesus Christ. And we could go on for a while. I'm going to hold what I'm going to say, and then let's finish playing the rest of the clip. But I have a lot to say.
All right. I'm going to tell you how this is going to go for the listener. We're going to play another clip from George Lucas, and we're going to go into some numbers of what's going on, how this is taking the world by storm. So, and then we're just going to talk about the rest of it. So here we go. This is George Lucas on an interview.
We can add Jedi to the pile. The book, The Return of the Serpents of Wisdom, just like George Lucas, also claims that Jesus Christ was a Jedi. But don't listen to me. Here's George Lucas telling you where he gets his stories from.
And I notice in The Phantom Menace, the new episode one, that they discover this slave child who has an aura about him. And it reminded me of how the Buddhists go out to look for the next Dalai Lama.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's, a mixture of all kinds of mythology and religious beliefs that have been amalgamated into the movie. I didn't want to invent a religion. I wanted to try to explain in a different way the religions that have already existed.
You're creating a new myth.
Well, I'm telling an old myth in a new way. I'm telling an old myth in a new way. I'm telling an old myth in a new way. I'm telling an old myth in a new way.
All right. So there, that's his own words, So, you know, when we used to talk about, hey, there's aspects of Hinduism in this. Oh, no, you're crazy. Or, you know, there's aspects of witchcraft, which is the light side and the dark side. Even in the new movie, you see the person that's supposed to be on the having the force awaken in her is wearing all white through the movie, and the person on the dark side is wearing all dark in the movie, and by the end of the movie, these two forces clash. And so symbolism is all over there, and the religious
but not only that, Chris,
keeps going.
Not only that.
Mm-hmm.
You have some other things that are going on. The one who is on the dark side, whenever he draws his sword, it's an upside-down cross.
Right, and you know, when I first heard that, I was like, wait a minute. There's other swords back in medieval days that are shaped like that. But when you look at the promotion of the movie, that sword hanging upside down, I was like, okay. You know, so the symbolism of the upside-down cross is definitely there. But in fact, as you heard in the last clip, that Jesus was thought to be a Jedi or whatever, right? But in episode one, they were talking about the kid that they found, the slave child. The Qui-Gon Jinn, one of the Jedi's, asked the mother, where's his father? And the woman said, I don't know where he came from. He basically she was just saying he just came. He was in her womb. There was no father. So, and then this quote unquote Jesus figure turns out to be more like an Antichrist figure, if you want to look at it like that. So, because he turns into Darth Vader and his prophecies and all these other things. But anyway, we're going to start going into how the movie has captured the audience. We're going to look at the numbers now, the actual figures that are going on right now, to show you that this train is not going to slow down anytime soon. So anyway, let me find the right clip here, and looking for the pre-orders. Here we go.
Hey, everyone here with Cinema Blend. We've got some news for you. Star Wars The Force Awakens.
Sorry, wrong clip. Here we go.
Hey, everyone here with Cinema Blend. We've got some news for you. We're still 2 months away from the release of Star Wars The Force Awakens, but the film has already broken multiple box office records. According to The Hollywood Reporter, it broke the record for advanced ticket sales on Fandango by more than 8 times. The previous record holder was The Hunger Games, which has now been left in the dust. It's also sold more advanced tickets for IMAX than any other film. IMAX has never had any more than 1 million in pre-sales on any given day, and The Force Awakens topped the $6.5 million mark. Theaters are trying to fit in extra screenings just to meet the demand. Experts say that it could have the biggest global opening weekend of all time. Between the tickets going on sale and the release of the full trailer, Star Wars is currently dominating the pop culture landscape, and this is only expected to increase as we get closer to its December 18th release date. This is News with Cinema Blend. We'll see you next time.
All right, so that's pre-order numbers. And if you don't understand what those numbers mean, okay, it costs around a little over $200 million to make the film. It made that in pre-orders. We're talking about IMAX. We're talking about people gobbling up movie tickets ahead of time. It was so bad that movie tickets websites were shut down for a little while because it was such an increase, such a demand for movie tickets. So, and that's just, like I said, pre-orders. It was so bad that people thought that on the first day or second day or third day or fourth day, you probably would get to see the movie because they heard about this big pre-order thing going on. So then the movie comes out and it broke all types of records. But this is a projection right here of the financial people are speculating.
Hey everyone, here with Cinema Blend. Got some news for you. Star Wars The Force Awakens is expected to break box office records, but exactly how much will Disney profit? Some experts are predicting $2.7 billion, which will pay back a fair amount of the $4 billion spent to purchase Lucasfilm. Well, expectations are so high that no matter what, they can't meet all of them, and this is not lost on J.J. Abrams, who said this to 60 Minutes. You just know that there will be people, no matter what you do, that will have issues with some aspect. You just know there is some number that is being thrown out there that will not be hit. You just know. In the same interview, Steven Spielberg had said that there is a ton of pressure on JJ to pay back Disney for the franchise they bought from Lucas, and that it's virtually impossible for him to actually succeed. There are those who believe it will be the biggest opening in movie history, which will mean they have to break $200 million in a month that's never seen a film break $90 million. Even Disney is trying to roll back expectations, given that they're at a point where anything besides being the biggest movie ever made could be considered a failure. It's a smart move to be realistic, but the film really could destroy every box office record the world has ever seen. Star Wars The Force Awakens will be released this Friday, and finally being able to say that feels pretty good. This is News with Cinema Blend. We'll see you next time.
All right. So there you have it. They project it making $2 billion, and there's a top movies of all time would be The Dark Knight. You have The Avengers, Titanic, Avatar, Gone with the Wind. So it's going to reach to that portion of movie sale tickets very quickly. And I have one more statistic to show you, but Rory, you have anything to add to that?
Well, just evil, bro. Just evil. How do I even say what I, there's so much. Just so much. It's, you know, they're making it seem that there's a force out there, and the force is neutral. The force can be either good or evil.
Yeah, or a blend of both.
Or a blend of both. I don't know how much the clip that we played earlier was talking about the aspects that weren't known about the people who are partaking in the movie and what are the things that they have done and how they have how they have made it so far. This is a part. This is a norm in Hollywood. This is a norm in Hollywood that has gone on for years. However, most of the people or all the people that are playing a part or a role in this are into witchcraft. And that's not surprising.
Yeah.
What are we exposing our children to?
And that's the whole thing about
that's
the whole thing about us covering it, because many people from many walks of life are going to go see this. I went to see it, and I didn't go to see it for the reason that many other people went to see it, but in just looking at what's in this, it's not like a bad film, but at the same time, it's not really a film that I would go buy four or five tickets. I mean, I don't know any movie I go buy four or five tickets for anymore, but you know what I mean? It's just people are going there and buying four or five, six, 10 tickets to go back. I remember watching a documentary one time on Star Wars that came on TV, and these people that were there were just like, I've seen Star Wars at least 150 times in the theater. I've seen Star Wars five, what? You know, they've said all these giant numbers. How many times can you sit in the theater and watch this movie? That's idolatry, you know? And I had to pull myself back from, that aspect when Man of Steel came out. I was like, wait a minute, I'm going to see this movie so many times because I enjoyed the special effects and some of the story, but yet I'm about to promote this thing like it's Jesus. How many people am I talking about Jesus to? You know? And that right there woke me up. That's idolatry. You want to go sit in front of the screen so many times. There's a person on YouTube that hosts a famous movie program, and he said Star Wars is his life. He cries over Star Wars, you know, stuff like that, and it's just ridiculous to me. But anyway, here are some more numbers to go with The Force Awakens. And it says here that Star Wars, The Force Awakens, has surpassed Titanic to become the second highest grossing domestic film of all time. Box Office Mojo, which reports box office totals for the majority of films across the globe, currently places the recently released film at $686 million in the U.S. through the weekend projections, though the weekend projections have it with $740 million by the end of Sunday. This should put it within striking distance of James Cameron's other Goliath, Avatar, which topped out at just over $760 million. The Force Awakens already became the highest-grossing Disney film ever, passing 2012's The Avengers in late December. With just a couple of weeks in the theaters under its belt, the latest episode in the Star Wars saga will almost certainly continue to rise, though where it finally ends up is speculation. So that is, and on top of that, too,
wow.
Yeah, on top of that, too, I read where the game now, the game has nothing to do with the movie, right? It's called Star Wars Battlefront, and it came out before the movie, but because of so much anticipation for the film, this game sold, I think, $6 million worth, 12 million games were sold, 12 million games, and no one predicted that. Even the people that made the game didn't predict it would sell 12 million. So this is a big machine that's just breaking in money right now on all fronts, because as it's known, Disney bought out Lucasfilm and the gaming branch of that too. So they're making money on all fronts. Then you talk about toys and all this other stuff. I mean, this is nothing new either, but we're talking about something that has dominated in a short space of time. But the elements within inside of it are dangerous to the kids that don't know better, or the parents that don't know better, the uninformed that think it's just innocent fun, when there's doctrine being taught in that movie, many different doctrines, in fact, that all go back to Satan. So,
and also many different imagery. There's a lot of imagery in there.
Yeah, a lot of imagery. When I'm sorry, if you haven't seen the movie and you hear us talking, we're going to talk about things that you probably don't want to hear if you didn't see the movie. So we're going to talk spoilers, too. When Han Solo finally gets it in the movie, you know, they're draining the sun and he's walking on the plank and darkness comes. You already know what's going to happen, but it's like no one expected it, and some people were very emotional over it because they're invested so much into this character. You know, and some people complain about it, say it could be handled better. You know, so much different type of imagery in the movie, a lot of, what do you call it, seeing the future, seeing the past thing when she touches the lightsaber there. And she goes into a trance, showing her different aspects of the past. And, you know, all of these things are, you find them in fantasy movies when you touch the orb and you see all type of things in the future or the past or whatever. These things come out of pagan practices. So the creator of the series, he did his homework and took things from the Bible, took things from here, took things from the Quran and other places, and just made a big story out of them. And like you heard him say, he's trying to tell the myth in a different way. Even though Jesus is not a myth, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one goes to the Father but through him. So a lot of these people that are in their cult, they like to mix Jesus up into their little sayings to make you feel a little better. You know, oh, they're not talking about Jesus bad, so let me listen to them a little bit. You know what I mean? And they drag people in with that. But they're not talking about the real Jesus at all. You know, when you hear Jesus mentioned in Islam, it's not the real Jesus. In Seventh-day Adventists, it's not the real Jesus. In Jehovah, if you get the wrong gospel, you got the wrong gospel. And Paul warned about that. You don't want to be among the accursed. Don't get the wrong gospel. Don't listen to these things that are in like an inclusion doctrine, where you see Jesus being included among these other so-called prophets, so-called gods, and even in mythology here. And there are many people attacking Jesus on many fronts. But in the end, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And that's just the way it is. You know, you don't want to keep going through this life not knowing who Jesus is. But this movie, this whole series, they plan on making a movie every year, I think up until 2020. So you're going to get a Star Wars movie every year. So you're not going to stop hearing about this.
Why do they plan to do that? Why? What are they planning to happen?
And, you know, that's an interesting question. But I see them following the slate that Marvel has put in order, which they own Marvel too now, by the way. So you come out with a series of films every year, it will keep the franchise going. Instead of letting it dissipate, like before, you get a film every 2 years or something like that, you know. But if they the model that they're following is you get a director to film this one, another director to film the other one, another that, and so you have these movies getting turned out every year as long as they make sure that the movies are entertaining, because obviously if they don't make money, it don't make sense, right? But there must be something else behind this whole thing in the shadow somewhere. I can't put my hand on the whole thing yet, but you know, things always come out. They come out a couple of years later or whatever. But
I can tell you, it's there to try to diminish Jesus Christ or Christianity. It's there saying that there is a force out there. It could be good or evil. And it's a lie from the pit of hell. And that's what it is. You know, like you said, Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. There is no one that can come to the Father but by me. So he uses the definite article. He didn't say, I am a way. He says, no, I am the way. I am the way. This is it. There is no other way. The way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And you talk about various other religions and how they try to diminish Christ. If you go to a Muslim, Muslim will tell you, hey, Jesus Christ was a prophet. No, Jesus Christ was the Son of God. And he came and he dwelt among men. He impacted lives. And lives were changed because of that. And even to today, you don't have, and I'm not going to say a Christian, I'm going to say a follower of Christ, or like they said in, I think, the first or second century, a follower of the way. You don't have them doing these things that you see going on in the world today, where they're violent and they're doing, no, that doesn't happen. You can't do that and follow Christ. You can't. And you know, I think maybe one of these days, I think, Chris, we're going to have to go back and look at in depth this movie, Star Wars, and the teachings that it has, and how people have formed a religion out of it.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have to really take a really deep look at it and look at transcendentalism. That's what it is. You know,
yeah.
We'll talk about that at a later show. But this is what it is. And people are taken away or give themselves over to these things. And here it is again. You go, you sit down, and you are being channeled to. You're channeled. You go and you sit down, and you have people that are pumping stuff into you, and they're giving you a lie.
Yes,
all I can say, my dear brother.
You know, if there's so much information out there about what's going on in this sector, that sector, the cult, and all these other things. It's sometimes it's hard to even catch up, and sometimes it's hard to kind of maneuver around it, because when you think something is safe, here comes something and you're like, whoa, in here too, you know? And it's not that you can't live, but it shows you why the Bible says don't love the world or the things in it. Don't have your heart so attached to something that the love of the Father is not in you. You know? So do not love the world or the things in it. Those that love the world, the love of the Father is not in them. You know, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. You know, and we cannot be so invested in something that you can't get pulled away from it. You know? Invest your time in God. Invest your time in your family. Invest your time in God. Invest your time in your family. You know, everything else, you know, I mean, yeah, invest time in church too. That goes along with God. But we're just saying that this world system, there's a lot of things, and, you know, kids will get annoyed at you. You know, other people get annoyed at you for pointing things out. But at least you're doing your job and trying to keep them safe, because there's so many things grasping for their attention and their soul, you know? And not everybody succumbs to the same thing. See, you got some people that are going into witchcraft, some people that get more fascinated with ghost stories, some people that get fascinated with fornication. And it is so many things after your attention to pull you away from Christ. I mean, if you're not saved, we plead to you today to turn to the one that died on the cross for your sins. God so loved the world, he gave his only son, his only begotten son, so that we wouldn't perish, but we could have everlasting life. And that's what it's all about, you know, regaining that relationship with God, the same relationship that Adam and Eve had, or maybe even better, because they didn't make it last that long, you know? Because we're going to see God again and be with him forever. And we're going to know what it really should have been like, you know? And if you're there in disbelief, you know, all I can say is just just bow your heart to Jesus and ask him to show you, is your Lord God, is this real? Is this real? And he will reveal himself to you, you know. And if you're a Christian, the waters are so muddy within Christianity right now that even when you tell the truth, you get looked at crazy. I remember the days when, truth used to ring in your ears like, what, for real? Boom, I got it. But now everything is skepticism, disbelief. Can't hold on to that. No, I don't know about that because I don't talk about my movie star because I love my movie star too much. I don't believe they did that or they said that. Or don't talk about my president or whatever. You know what I mean? Go ahead, Rory.
What I wanted to read was a passage from Scripture. All right? And this is Jude 1. When I read it, I'm going to highlight the part that I'm going to talk about briefly. It said, Jude, a servant of Christ Jesus and a brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father and preserved in Jesus Christ and called, mercy unto you and peace and love be multiplied. Beloved, when I gave you all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you by that ye should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. I'm going to stop right here. I'm not even going to go on. Well, let me read on to the next one. For there are certain men that crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to the condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness and denying the Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, contend for the faith that was given to you. Contend, fight for it. Seek God. Read his word. This year, 2016, God has given us all another opportunity that even if we messed up all of last year or even before, he has given us an opportunity that we can go back and say, Lord God, help me. If you're not saved, show me. For you that are saved, hey, Lord, I want to really earnestly hunger and thirst after you. I want you to show me, your Lord God, the things that you have for me, the things that you have for me to do. Because the Bible says, I think it's the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. It's not the things that you see out there in the world. The three things consist of righteousness, consist of peace, and it consist of joy. Three things that you should know about a Christian. You should be able to tell a person is a Christian. Are they walking righteously with God? Peace. Is there peace in their life? And is there joy? That's all I got to say. We need to focus on him. Focus on who is the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ. And that we come to know him and contend for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Fight for it. I'm not saying fight with a gun. Fight with the flesh. And fight to see what it is that he has in his word for you. Lord God, show us what you'd have us to know and do so we can walk according to the word of the living God and do great exploits according to the word of God. Amen?
Amen. Amen. So, people out there listening, if you listened before, you know how some of our shows go, and we got a lot of things planned for you. If you're young, we're reaching out to you, the teenagers, for anyone from teenage to 35. you know, you
could be older too. It's fine.
You could be, yeah.
It's
and
fine.
Everybody else in between. And everybody else in between. Everybody else in between. But
it's fine.
We are everybody. Yeah. But our core focus is to reach you young guys and girls to just give you the word of God and to speak into your life with things that reflect the face of God, because we know about the hurt out there. we know about the problems you go through. We know about the influence on the culture. We understand, because we might not, you know, be young and growing up in the same thing that you're growing up, but we've been there. The culture isn't dead. So we know exactly what you're going through. The problems with fatherlessness, relationships, influence, peer pressure, your sexuality. The world is telling you ungodly things about your sexuality. And the system that you're growing up in is just pushing you into Satan's arm. There's so much to talk about, so much to talk about, so much to cover. But we want you to tune in and get free from the satanic system that you've been basically born in. But we don't want you to continue being brainwashed by the music, by the TV, and by everything else that's coming to destroy you, that's against the will of God. So we just want to, you know, encourage you to listen. We got some things planned that are going to speak to your spirit. In Jesus' name.
And the only way, amen, and the only way that can be done, like Chris said, is by the word of God. And listen, folks, we are just here sharing some of the things that the Lord has laid on our heart. And we're sharing with you some of the things that are happening in the world, some of the things that you might hear of. But greater is he who is in me. That's what the word of God says. I'm a born-again believer. So greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. The things that I see that are going on out there, I shouldn't worry. I shouldn't be afraid. We're going to talk about them. But my source, my focus is Christ. And he has left us a roadmap of what we should do and follow. He said in his word, his word is like a lamp unto our feet. It lights up around us. And it gives us a light unto our pathway. It shows us where to go, how to live. The pathway is how to live, how to walk out this life, how to be successful in this life. It's following the word of God. And that's pretty much it that I want to share. Amen.
Amen. And that's our show, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for joining us, and good night. Amen.